I've been in this industry a while, and I've had a few ideas rattling around in my brain. So my attempt here is to have a discussion about some of those ideas, and I'd like anybody, if they've got any ideas, to please, you know, step up and suggest them. If I start ranting, just yell out rant. So here's the obligatory agenda. Who's this guy? What are we talking about? Your classic security team. Where does it fit in the organization? Maybe some of the environmental issues it has to endure. And some suggestions about how it could actually fit in the organization. And then any additional questions, but please jump in at any time. So here's the gratuitous slide that tells you why you should listen to me.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's a direct quote from Tanya. I like beer. Any questions? So I don't really want this to be a presentation. I really want it to be a discussion, because, you know, how many here are in dev? How many here are in a security group that's in a quality organization? So we all have stories about how that works, it doesn't work, things like that. So that's why I want to find out what works. What are the environmental things that help it achieve and influence that success, or maybe even its failure. So I've already asked this question. So what does the typical security team look like? Maybe? Maybe not. But regardless, it's got a few characteristics. You might have different backgrounds, you might know different technologies, you might interact with people differently. You might have a varied history. But at the end of the day, typically every team I've been in had that one Achilles heel. We were all passionate about that security, whatever it might be. And as that team worked together, those individual skills helped it make a broader successful team. And the roles that team would have could be varied, it could be singular, but it could also it could be more attack-oriented in terms of the red team. You might be doing just pure pen tests, or static code analysis, or just pure audits. Or it could be a combination of being more blue team-ish, doing threat models, maybe risk analysis, how to do mitigations, helping development teams be more secure and think more about security. Maybe they're more consultative. But at the end of the day, whether it's blue team, whether it's red team, whether it's a plaid team, at the end of the day, you have that goal of making sure things don't get very stupid. So how do you put that, where do you put that team to achieve that success? You want to be effective, you want to be respected, you want to have people say, yeah, that team, they're the ones that are going to help me. You want to be efficient at doing. You want to be maybe anything else that I haven't mentioned here that might be useful. But at the end of the day, we need to understand what are those weak conditions. And, or those non-winning conditions, so we can try to avoid them. And there's a number of different environment variables that are going on. Yeah, it's an environment variables, it's been a long day. There's a number of variables to that environment that affect how your success will succeed or not succeed. And a big one to me that I've encountered is environment. And that can be a combination of the politics of an organization. It's, there's an oxymoron, corporate culture. It could be where it's placed in the structure, and that could affect the politics. Maybe it's the skills that team has, and are they appropriate to the organization? Or maybe there's not enough process, maybe there's too much process, maybe it's the wrong process, but there are still processes involved. So I'm going to talk a few for a few slides about what kind of environment I've encountered that the team I've been involved in has resided in. Now, before I keep rattling on just because of the caffeine I've consumed, has there been any questions, any epiphanies yet? No? I can keep rattling on. So, I have been in development for a long time, even when I had hair. And I switched from a development group to a security group, which I didn't realize, not that it should really matter, but it was in a quality group. And as one of my colleagues said to me, when they realized I was moving to this other team, and I have to take my glasses off for that, because the facial expression is important, they said, but that's a quality group. And I sort of was gobsmacked. It's like, well, what the hell is she talking about? So? And I realized then I was a lamb to the slaughter. I realized then that there was this entire, I don't know, divide between different groups, at least in the company I was at the time. And I had never encountered that before. So that was one environmental thing I was completely unaware of. Maybe there's some in the environment, there's some misunderstanding about the role of security issues and how they should be dealt with. You know, maybe there's, you know, what is this thing? It's a bug, you know, this isn't important to me. You know, maybe there's some misunderstanding about the actual importance of what that is. Maybe there's a political environment going on that you're not aware of, or some teams are not. You laugh. That's a direct quote. You know, maybe there's some sort of weirdness going on in terms of the politics of the things we find. Maybe there's some people who've never really interacted well with a security team or understand how to engage with a security team. And maybe they really don't understand the skills a security team brings to the table. You stopped laughing, so. Maybe there's a skills gap in other places that needs to be worked on. And then maybe there's this other misunderstanding about the development processes being used. Or maybe they're just modifying it to suit their needs. Sometimes I have to stop and think about this one. Maybe they're not aware of things like defense in depth. And continuing on with defense in depth, maybe they just don't know how to engage with a certain, you know, security team or when to actually engage with it. While I was thinking of all these things, I sort of was thinking, what are the factors that are involved in this? You know, clearly there's maybe some attitudes going on here. Maybe there's some management issues that need to be addressed or resolved. Maybe there's some leadership things happening, and maybe there's a culture. And as I looked at this slide, as I'm, you know, sort of, you know, fat-fingering, making the slide, I'm looking at this, and I realized that I kind of had a causality going on here, in that, hey, I can take bullet points and turn it into a sentence, and that sometimes there is a direct chain of causality between some of these different environmental factors that we're getting. So that's some of the factors affecting the environment. The other thing I sort of noticed, because I've worked in a few different places in the world, and I've sometimes noticed a difference as I've gone to different countries, how some of those places deal with quality or understand it and address that in terms of security team terms. I've had a very different encounter in Europe versus in North America. Now, I mean, I'm only one person. These are only my observations. It's not a, you know, it's not a double-blind study. But I'm supposed to hold the microphone here. I've encountered a true difference between Canada and the United States and then North America versus Europe. So I don't know if anybody else has any other international experiences that they could bring to the table. You know, is there a place that if you find a security bug, they run out and shoot you? I don't know.
Just to give us a reference, what's the size of the organizations that you've dealt with?
Anything from a couple of thousand to 50,000 and up. So.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, sorry. Yes, the question was, did I see a difference? What were some of the sizes of organizations that I dealt with? There. I'm not ranting yet. So, the other thing that will affect how we engage with security is some of the, you know, development mantras and methodologies that we use. You know, we've heard of waterfall, we've heard of agile, and we've all heard of FISA. Everybody's heard of FISA? You've encountered that. It's called fuck it, ship it. I'm here all week trying to figure out. So, I know we've got to make money, right? You know, we've got to make coin, we've got to, you know, push product out there. The clients have to buy it, and we have to make money, right? So nobody's arguing that we can't, right? We don't have to make coin. But at some point in time, if you choose Agile for a reason, but you still try to push it out, something out the door by a certain time that is squeezed to get it out the door, then maybe it's not Agile. So maybe we're modifying things to suit our needs. And then sometimes we really don't understand how that necessarily works in terms of a security context. Is it that checkbox to check? Or can we just become checkbox and checkers? Or is it a case of we're engaged early enough so we can work with some of these environments? Otherwise, we'll end up with something like this. Can you see it? So this is one of those classic, the guy with the glasses is saying, yes, we need to get security, and we need to get security, and we need to get security in every tile in the cartoon. And there are various reasons for not doing it. We don't have the time or the budget for that. That's not the priority. We have to get the project started first. We'll take care of it later, don't worry. And then, of course, the canary in the coal mine is the one who gets blamed for not taking care of it. So while we've sort of considered some of these issues in terms of environments, where do we put security requirements? And so I've got a couple of examples that I've encountered and suggestions. So if you have any different ones, please suggest it. This is version 1.0 of the slide, so if you suggest something, it might become version 1.1. So what I'll call the traditional, it sounds like a pizza list, but the traditional is what I would call a team within a quality group. And if, like with any structure, it has pros and it has cons. One of the pros is that you get an overall, it becomes part of the overall quality management of the actual product, and that's probably a good thing. But one of the real benefits is you're outside of the management chain of a development organization. So you're not, your review, your salary review, all the benefits of working with an organization is not tied to you stopping the release of product. So your goal is quality, but you're not necessarily being penalized for hindering the release. The problem that I've found traditionally is that they're engaged late. The classic, we've got 2 days before release, can you do a pen test? You're bumping typically into that divide in North America between a quality group and a development group. And then finally, you're really dependent on the politics and the culture of that organization to want to engage with the security team. The other one that I've been involved in is what I'll call the gunslinger or lone wolf. And I've been really successful with this one. And this is where I'm embedded in a development team, and I'm involved in the not only the pen testing of the product, but I'm also bringing in security features. And so I'm there early in the cycle. I'm in the team, so I'm not necessarily outside of the cultural influence between the quality and the development. I'm inside the tent, pissing out. So I'm avoiding any of those particular cultural issues. The problem is that my boss, who's doing my review, might be upset if I stop the release of a product because of a security issue. Now, hopefully, theoretically, if I'm early in the cycle, that won't be an issue. But there's one thing I've learned about software development, and that is shit happens. So, you know, maybe it needs some work. The other thing I wanted to mention about this is that you could be in this group. You could have a Teflon-coated product that's very, very impervious to security. But if they haven't made a clone army of you, then what about the other products and components that surround you? Are they going to be weak? Will they be the weakest link? So we don't have scalability with this one, unless you figured out the clone army. So what I'm going to now suggest is a third way. And I think there's probably 20,000 ways, but this is one that I'm sort of thinking about. And I'll call it hybrid, or my favorite name is commissar. And the reason I call it commissar is that in the Soviet army, or in the Soviet military units, they will have the political officer. And okay, maybe it's a crappy metaphor, but it worked in that you have a security team with a separate management structure, but with an individual embedded in more than one team. Again, you might have the actual scalability issue, but at the end of the day, you try to get all the benefits of being the gunslinger and try to reduce all the disadvantages of being in a traditional mode. Okay, it's a theory. So then, does anybody else do anything different?
You could have a subsection of a security team called the application security team, and ideally they would do testing and education for developers and interact with developers and help them with tough security-related issues.
But they would be part of a security team and
yeah.
A quality group, but then they would be sort of like a motorcycle gang that would roll around in different other development groups. And is that sort of what you're thinking?
I theorize that one day they'll be more than just me.
I'm waiting for you to show up with a motorcycle.
I think she has a valid point. I think that's what we need to do is need to sort of read this into the fabric of the development teams, and need an education. I do think that a lot of these security concerns do get overlooked. And yes, I agree, you need to have these quality teams and you need to have these security experts. And it would be great if you could integrate them into the teams. A lot of the times, those people are unicorns. They just don't exist. There aren't enough of them.
Yes, you're right.
Right?
So
I think that's where we are in the software industry. Is we need more of this. We need great more. Like, you're spot on.
Okay, so the suggestion is that because there is a gap in terms of, and step on me when I get it wrong, he's going to give everyone $5 Nokis. So because there is a gap in terms of supply and demand for security professionals, that will always be a problem. So we need to imbue individual development teams with that security knowledge. And so having Tanya run around with a motorcycle, going to all these different teams, that would help with the education process. Cool. I had a great idea and now I forgot all of it. No, it's your fault. It's her, no, it is. It's her fault. No. There was another question.
Oh, yeah, was that one when you're done? Because I have to follow up. No.
it's a tough act to follow.
Absolutely, I was going to say that. So the hybrid you said, where you have someone that is out and in, sounds like it's a combination. Can't you have the security group, right, that is part of the quality group application security, and then somebody designated within the development organization that is not necessarily a security, right?
But
it's kind of like your champion, your focal, yes, and they get training. They work with the experts.
Right.
Right.
Do you mean an application security
evangelist?
Oh. That's, I didn't know. That's such a cool name.
So we have a new swear jar. If anybody says the word evangelist, ecosystem, organic, they have to put $5 in the business swear jar. We'll put something on our meetup page. You can add to that. We'll then give out bingo cards. I like that idea, and in fact, if we find a champion and the commissar does the appropriate political indoctrination, then we might be able to scale.
So somewhere where I used to work, where I was greatly outnumbered, what I did was is I gave all the developers Zap, and then I had them all scan their code for me. Yeah, Zap is the WASP Zed attack proxy, which is a vulnerability scanner, and then I made them do my work for me. And then if they found something, I came up with this grid of what they had to fix, and then links, and then like just kept kind of building them up. And then eventually, like by the time things got to the end, like I'm like, if my vulnerability scanner sees something, I'm gonna come to your desk and make fun of you. And so eventually, like each team had their zapper, and it kind of, they're still doing it as far as I know.
I think I prefer the idea of tasers, but anyways.
soft touch.
Nobody else. Anyways, that's been kicking around in my brain. If you have any questions, alternatives, suggestions.
So I think one of the reasons this security gets overlooked by the development teams is that they have no direct incentive to make it secure. They have direct incentive to ship on time, you know, on budget, whatever. But I've never seen, you know, being an incentive for them to ship security.
If in case anybody didn't hear that, there is no incentive for people to be writing secure code or be secure in their development process. Because it's not a feature, it's not a function, nobody can put it on a line item. So yes, and it is an intangible that only becomes tangible after it's too late. And so you're essentially, it's very hard to make people do the right thing as opposed to threatening them if they do the wrong thing. It's sort of like, you know, which do you think you'll make more money on? Running a gym or selling cigarettes and booze?
Bad reflection, girl.
I'm nothing if I'm not cynical. Oh, what? This isn't Cynics Anonymous.
Adam? No, just to add on to that comment, I think as more and more shops are going more towards a continual development, DevOps sort of posture, like a project manager has to be accountable for their project in operations being successful after they pass the torch, I think developers also have to have some responsibility once it is in production, once it's in operations. They have to have some skin in the game when it comes to that. They can't just punch it over the fence. Hey, we got the release out. Great, let's wait till the next one. And, you know.
It's a dry irony that now development is the owner of their own product.
do is like pull stunts. That's what I do. So like I had this big pen test done on something, like I paid someone else to come in and do it, and it was like just a disaster. And no one would fix anything, and everyone was ignoring me, so I just wrote up a list of risks and all the bad stuff that could happen, and then mailed it to the chief information officer and the department of security officer and said, could you sign off on these risks? And then I got a call, God damn it, Tanya, I'm gonna sign this piece of shit. And I made it like 50 pages long. I was like, the building's gonna burn down and my hair is on fire. And then I'm like, can I tell them Bill sent me? And then I was just like, Bill sent me, and everyone's like, ah, and everyone fixed everything. Or another thing you can do, like David was talking about, I totally did this at work 2 weeks ago. Click here to win a free iPad, and then I emailed it to someone with something bad. And they're like, we'll go fix that. Thanks. So sometimes, like, you can't pull stunts all the time, but, like, if it's really bad, pull a stunt. That's a suggestion. Maybe I shouldn't have said that. Are you more? More stuff?
Tanya, I was going to put some of that in my work. Can you sign off on that, though, before I do that? So you can blame me for that?
No, don't blame me. Not like a stunt that hurts anyone.
Oh, that's something I want to find here. There is a site called Programmer, I believe it's called Classic Programmer Paintings. And it's a hoot because they take traditional works of art and then they caption it with some sort of development. And so in, sorry, I can't limbo and click. And in here, there'll be one that, of course I can't search, but there'll be one for the sword.
Inside the frame, your top left.
Well, there's search in here? Ah, search. So. Action is directly proportional to the number of people watching you. Here we go. So, who's familiar with the Sword of Damocles? The story of the Sword of Damocles. So, there's Damocles, he's a king guy, he's got a court, people are saying, oh yeah, you've got such a great job, right? You know, you've got a real sweet crib here, it's really nice, but they don't understand the responsibility of the job, so please sit in my throne. And so somebody has to sit in the throne, but then they understand that the sword of Damocles can drop on them at any time. And the reason I submitted this to this site was because my caption said, and this goes to Tammy's point, Damocles discusses threat model and penetration test results with tech lead. I am the Sword of Damocles, and I have brought servers down. I'm done.